The presenting sponsor for On Education is Schoology. Schoology is not only the best learning management system, it's also a community of lifelong learners. Join On Education at the Schoology Next Conference July 16th through 18th in San Diego, California. This is a chance to immerse yourself in hands-on workshops, advanced product training sessions, and best practice presentations. If you want to learn more about Schoology and how they can help you advance what's possible, visit Schoology.com. Friends, we have an amazing pod for you today. They don't have anything.
Trust us. Welcome to On Education. I'm Mike Washburn.
And I'm Glenn Irvin. Friends, we have an amazing pod for you today. We're going to talk about edtech companies tracking students' feelings, the future of the school bus, the future also of Flipgrid and Microsoft, and we will chat about Teacher Gaming's new City Skylines EDU.
This podcast is about the future.
This is all about future.
We are forward-looking
here. The future is here.
We are here.
We are here. Yes, we are.
In Chicago.
Yes, and we're face-to-face. I guess this is the first real full episode, I guess.
Yes.
Of the podcast where we're actually here sitting across from each other.
It's exciting.
Yes, it is.
It's been a lot of work to get to this point.
Yes.
But we're excited to be here, and this is a blast. Chicago is beautiful. I love Chicago. I've been here a lot lately. And it's been a nice day. Haven't been outside much, but you know, you can see it from outside. You can see it through the windows, and you look, oh, that looks nice. but in general, it's been super nice, and we're here. Holy moly, it's been a fun ride so far, I think.
Yes. No, I mean, it's been awesome, and what's been crazy in my life is that I have now finally left.
You're gone.
The town of Wabasha, which is where I've lived for the past 13 years. We've actually packed up our stuff into one of these storage containers where you put all your stuff in there. And then you hope that you have another house, which I don't have one yet.
You're homeless.
And then you just kind of, we're just in the home buying process, and it's crazy. I wanted to make sure, though, that I said goodbye to, there's a ton of really, really good friends that we made along the way. And really at the end, when you leave a place, you really get to see your impact. I mean, you get to feel the impact that you've actually made, not only myself, but my wife, and of course, my kids too, and then the people that have both affected us, you know, personally, and then how we've affected them. And we want to make sure that everybody knows too, back at Wabasha, that we'll be back for all kinds of things. We're going to make sure that we still keep our connections there. We're only really 3 hours away, so it's not like we're moving across the country.
Right.
So we want to make sure that we keep those connections. And good luck to all of you guys back in Wabasha. We really love you guys. I want to make sure I included that in there, because I know some of my former colleagues and also my students do listen to the podcast.
How long did you live there?
13 years.
Well, that's a long time for anybody.
Yes, yes. So I started when I probably still had a little bit of hair. It was right around when I was 30. Actually, I was 29, and then now I'm 42. So,
well, and none of your kids were all born there then.
Yeah. Yep. My kids have only known Wabasha as their home, so this is going to be a new experience for them and new schools. Mm. But we're excited about the prospects of it.
Cool. Cool. Hey, so you came across a bunch of stuff. There's a bunch of interesting stuff here.
Yes.
First one.
Yeah. So the first one is an article out of EdWeek. And it is it's an article about edtech companies and them tracking basically students' feelings. Now, by that, we actually were at the Badge Summit, and someone mentioned a term that's actually mentioned inside of this article, which basically what it is the collection of the behaviors of how students interact with software, and then tracking those behaviors to be able to go ahead and make better software for learning, right? So, of course, it's an awesome, powerful thing, but it's also really powerfully creepy, because
I was almost going to say, isn't this illegal?
Yes, but it's not illegal. What it's tracking basically is how often students will click on things, interact with things, how long they will stay on something, and it's tracking all of this data.
Because it's web-based, right? So they're making a heat map of like where people's cursors go,
yes,
and tracking the clicks, which you can... pretty easily, like, there's scripts that do that for websites. So yes. I guess it's not illegal.
No, it's not. But it's interesting, I mean, because there's two sides to it. One of it is that the sites become much smarter. So you're talking about artificial intelligence basically able to intuitively tell what more than likely you want next. So kind of like when we're texting and then that next word pops up, it's just basically, you know, that's all programmed in there. But this is doing the exact same thing for learning types of software. So it's tracking all that data. And then the opposite side where they say, I don't know if I want you tracking every single thing about what I actually do. So
But I mean, of course there's value.
There's value, but then we're giving up some of our privacy like we always do, I guess, in most things, right?
Yeah.
Yes, yes. And so the next thing that I had on my list about weird things was the future of the school bus. Did you read this one?
No.
No, well, basically what it was saying was that this article, which was out of U.S. News and World Report, that what they're thinking is basically that buses are not really that economical, especially for a lot of times within cities, let's say.
Okay.
And so what the article is proposing is that basically that ride sharing will replace traditional school buses. So kind of like the way that Uber and Lyft works, that there will be some sort of that kind of organized abilities to be able to give rides to students to their school.
But then you have like 20 million cars in the parking lot. Like,
no, but they would just drop them off. Yeah, it's not like they would actually still be there. I actually caught it when I was reading it. I was like, okay, how can this actually work? But it really explained it really well. It's in California and Colorado that they're thinking about, instead of having these, you know, buses that they purchase and maintain and whatever it might be, that maybe we should have cars and SUVs and vans. You know what I mean?
But do you have a big, like, do you have lots of buses at your school? Because we don't.
Yes.
Almost all of our kids are driven to school.
Yeah.
Our parking lot is a gong show as it is.
Yeah, no.
And this would turn all bus schools parking lots also into gong shows.
No, but what we have, especially in rural Minnesota, what we have is, for example, the Wabasha Kellogg, the place I was at for 13 years, we actually hired a third party that has a bunch of buses that they maintain, that we basically have a leasing agreement with them.
Yeah.
And that agreement, that transportation of those students, because it's such a large district, is super expensive.
Of course it is.
But it's super important, you know, to be able to get the kids to school, obviously.
Things cost money, man.
But this is saying, why are we using these super large one kind of stop shots where you have to collect all the students and then bring them to all these stops? Isn't it more economical? And they've actually done the analysis that it is more economical to have vans instead of these large buses, or actual cars for specific students that maybe live further and further away. So it's a really interesting look at it. And in the way that they're able to go ahead and make it all happen is the same technology that we would have for like Uber or Lyft or any of those kinds of things. So it's interesting.
Kids should just walk more.
We can't walk like 13 miles to school.
When I was your age,
I know what you're gonna say.
I walked 30 miles barefoot, uphill both ways,
I was gonna
in 10 feet of snow. So don't cry to me about buses.
Yes, and we all know that that's not true. All right, so then the last thing was actually something that we've been talking about. And the biggest takeaway from this one is basically it says schools use esports as a learning platform.
Cool.
The biggest takeaway, though, from this is a quote there where it says that esports isn't the next big thing, you know, the next big thing. It's actually happening right now. And it's happening in high schools, in junior highs, and it's even happening at the collegiate level. And we know that Steve Isaacs is a big proponent of that. They have the esports EDU chat. And I think it's just going to grow bigger and bigger, Mike. I think that people are starting to see the value that these teams actually, you know, the skills that they're developing are very similar to the team skills that they're developing in athletics also, you know, or whatever it
100%.
Is that they're actually participating in. So we're going to make sure we link that article too, as far as the esports as a learning platform.
Well, so I just noticed who wrote it.
Yes, who did write it?
So this is Constance Stein. I'm going to screw up her last name. Steinkuhler.
Okay.
But that's Kurt Squire's wife.
Is it?
And these two are you know, wicked smart. Yeah, yes. Yeah. So she's brilliant.
Yes.
And so, listen, if Constance is behind esports, then, listen, the world better get ready.
Because it's happening.
Yes. Because these two have collectively predicted, like, wave after wave of game-based learning stuff for the last 15 or 20 years.
And for you guys that don't know esports, basically all it is organized, like it says right here.
Game competitions.
And it's a variety of different games.
Yeah.
So it's not just all, like, some people believe, you know, it might be like a first-person shooter or something like that. There's a variety of different types of skill games, all kinds of different things. We've talked about some of them as far as in past shows, but just so people can have an idea about what these esports are.
Yeah, so yes. I mean, read this article, because if anyone would know about how this is going to work from a actual, like, hardcore, weedsy type perspective, Constance is going to know what's up. So that's pretty interesting stuff. When we come back, we're going to talk about something else that's pretty interesting, the future of Flipgrid.
Teachers, if you're interested in game-based learning, you simply have to check out Teacher Gaming. Mike, we are giving away a one-year subscription to Teacher Gaming.
Teacher Gaming has so many games, I can't even keep track of it all. 30 games, 1 year subscription is just enough time to get into all of them.
Yes. So to enter, all you need to do is simply tweet a picture, a little pic of your favorite game. It could be a desktop type of game. It could be something you actually play, like, far as a video game or something handheld.
World of Warcraft.
Yeah, any of those, yes. And you need to just send it to @teachergaming and tag on @oneducationpod. And that's it. Even if you aren't the winner, though, right, Mike?
Even if you aren't the winner, you're still a winner to us.
Yeah, you're still a winner, and you can still get a 30-day free trial and test it out for yourselves by simply going to teachergaming.com.
Everyone wins. All right, friends, welcome back to the podcast. Big news, huge news this week. Flipgrid, your favorite video sharing / community / whatever website / app was bought by Microsoft. Like, holy crap. So, I mean, big, huge news. It was pretty amazing. Everyone, you know, goes, what?
Yes.
So, yeah, what do you think?
Well, first of all, it wasn't just the purchase of it. But the way that they announced it is really what's insane about it, because a lot of us, I mean, if you were going to name off the top apps that teachers currently use, I think that in the top five, maybe even sometimes in the top three, people would name off Flipgrid.
100%.
Yes.
Except for me.
Yes, except for
some reason. Yes. We're going to talk about that in a second.
But still, and it's used in a variety of different content areas. I actually purchased in previous years for my Spanish classes the one-year license.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
I was like...
How much was it?
I think it was around $55 or $60.
For a year.
It wasn't super expensive, and there was a lot of features that were available. Like, for example, a student could respond to a student with mm-hmm. the paid one. Mm-hmm. And you could create as many grids as you want to.
Mm-hmm.
And the other one was limited. So the biggest news, though, when Microsoft purchased this, is they announced that now Flipgrid is free.
Dun, 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 dun.
Free. I mean, so the teacher version, the one that used to be the paid version that I paid, whatever, $50 for or $60 for, it's now free.
And I think they refunded people prorated.
They're doing that right now. Yes, they're going to have a refund process to anybody that already had upgraded it.
Isn't that something?
It's crazy, and it kind of, like, you know, it messed with my mind a little bit.
You get why they're doing it, though.
Why are they doing it?
So the same reason that Apple gives away their stuff for free, like upgrades to GarageBand. New GarageBand is free. Pages is free. Keynote is free.
Okay.
They're trying to lock people into Microsoft stuff.
Okay.
And they've actually almost explicitly said that. So I've read some of the content, but one of the things they say is that we want people to love Microsoft products. And by allowing people to use Flipgrid for free, you then tend to want to maybe keep using other Microsoft products as well.
Yes.
There's an ecosystem play here, and it's great. Listen, not complaining at all. This is amazing.
I'm complaining.
Are you really?
I mean, there's a quote here, though. It says, we're diligently, as the corporate vice president for Microsoft says, we're diligently committed to making sure their platform, Flipgrid, products continue to work across the Microsoft, Google, and partner ecosystems to benefit students and teachers everywhere. So my thing is, will they continue to work on those other platforms, for the future.
Yeah,
right now they work, and they work in a multitude. That was so cool about Flipgrid, man.
Because it was web-based, right? So yeah, you could use it on a Chromebook.
You could use it on an iPad. You could use it on anything. Yeah, so you can embed it into anything. So we used to embed it right into Schoology or whatever it was that we were doing, or if you have Google Classroom, you could embed it right into the system that you wanted, and it didn't have any of those massive conflicts
barriers
that other things have. The barriers, yes. Yeah. It eliminated a bunch of those barriers. And it's such an awesome tool. And I'm happy that teachers don't have to pay. Don't get me wrong.
So you're not angry. You're just nervous.
I'm very nervous. Because I'm wondering, what's the true play behind
this?
Well,
listen, I mean, Microsoft is Microsoft, and Microsoft is going to do Microsoft things. Just like Apple is Apple, and they do Apple things, and Google, they're the three, and they do their things. And we know what they're doing. I mean, we're not dumb.
Okay.
There's a play here, but I'm not sure it's malicious. And listen, if they said, 2 or 3 years from now, that Flipgrid is going to be a Windows 10, Windows 11, whatever it is, Windows only application.
Yeah.
Flipgrid would all of a sudden no longer be
that popular
at all.
I think so too.
There would be a revolt.
I agree.
People would take to the streets.
Yeah. I mean, here's just an example. If you have to log in with a Microsoft 365 account,
There are districts that don't even have that, right? It would lock everyone out.
Yeah, that's what I'm telling you. So you guys
saw what happened.
Don't do that.
Right, no.
Yes.
Please.
Please.
I mean, we saw what happened even when just like Padlet says we need to charge people money. There was like a full scale
revolt.
Yeah.
Including us.
Pitchforks. Right?
Taken to the streets.
So, I mean, but if Flipgrid, there are people walking around here wearing Flipgrid t-shirts.
They love it.
They would be no longer wearing Flipgrid t-shirts.
I agree.
And I tell you, some of the people who are wearing Flipgrid t-shirts would be losing their freaking minds if Flipgrid did this. And you would hear about them because there's some pretty vocal people wearing Flipgrid t-shirts.
Yes. Yes.
So let's, have some perspective here. Don't make us nervous, Microsoft. Do the right thing.
Please.
Literally be cool about this because I think that, and I have faith. I'm feeling okay about this. I'm not super nervous. I don't know if there's a strong track record to suggest that they would screw this up.
I hope not.
Do you disagree?
No, I don't want to bring anything else up.
So, right, well, no, because I know you're thinking, you're talking about Minecraft.
Yes, I'm talking about Minecraft.
And that's fine. So
I just don't like the, okay, so for example, to be able to play.
Let's do this.
Now I'm going through this. So I just don't like that a Minecraft Education Edition, we have to log in with Office 365 accounts.
Do you have to?
Yes. You have to create them, and you have to log in with them. And,
okay.
And that is a barrier, like you just explained.
Yes.
Now, some people may go, well, they're free and blah, blah, blah. Well, some of us are Google schools, and some of us don't have, 365 accounts. And
can you create a 365 account with
free.
A Gmail address?
Yes,
sure,
I think
you can.
Yes, you can. Yes,
okay.
But the way that it works, I mean, it's what you just talked about. They want you to get into their ecosystem. They want you to go ahead and purchase
But
their
they're not
products.
Locking people out.
They're not locking people out that much.
It's not still, in a way that's actually real.
They're just
saying you need to use this to create an account. It's like, if you want to play a game on Steam, you got to have a Steam account. I mean, it is what it is.
I guess. Yeah, that's what I said. I don't want to bring it up, but now that I did, I'll just go ahead and say, call it good. Flipgrid, you are so awesome, and I hope that Microsoft does well by you.
Yeah. So when this news came up, I've never used Flipgrid before.
Okay.
I'll tell you, I barely even heard of Flipgrid. I don't know why. I'm just,
Well,
whatever.
I'm under a rock.
Probably. I'll be honest. Yeah. I'm sure I'd heard of it. I just use other tools, and sure. It is what it is. But as soon as I saw the announcement, Glenn, you sent it to me. I'm looking at it, and I signed up, and like, what a tool this thing is.
It's amazing.
So I do with my game design challenge reflections. I've normally had kids write them.
Mm-hmm.
And they use Google Sites, and some of them make websites. I had a student last year do like a journal, like a handwritten journal. And I mean, I'm debating whether to make all of or ask all of them to use Flipgrid for the reflections, or just add this to the toolbox of things they could possibly use.
Yes.
To offer a reflection.
It's a really
either
good way
either
of doing
way,
it.
This is an amazing tool for reflective learning for
yes.
for kids thinking about what they've been taught doing and what they've been taught. And talking about it, and there are lots of kids that can talk, and they just, especially if they know that they don't got to stand up in front of class.
Yes,
this is the tool for the kid that doesn't like to get up in class, but does have things to say.
Absolutely, gives them a voice.
Right, and so I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. And I'm going to use it next year, and
good.
I'm really excited. So, yeah. This is pretty cool news, and it's really interesting. So we'll leave it at that.
Yes.
And we'll just see what happens. When we come back, we are going to talk with Glenn about Teacher Gaming's City Skylines EDU.
On Education is brought to you by Audible. Mike, what have you been reading lately? And I suppose you're kind of like me, where you have quite a few books that you have on your list.
I have too many books on my list. I have probably about 40 audiobooks on my queue, and between listening to podcasts and audiobooks, I am well stocked. Lots of cool books are on Audible, hundreds and thousands of titles, and you can get your own audiobook download for free if you go to audibletrial.com/oneducation. That's audibletrial.com/oneducation. And you can get a free audiobook download. You should go do that, like, right now.
All right, welcome back to the show. We got access to City Skylines EDU. It's a teacher gaming, their newest real video game, for lack of better words, that they've turned into an EDU version of. Glenn has had a chance to play it a bit with his son. First things first, we should tell people what City Skylines... I know we've talked about it before,
sure.
Because it's an awesome game.
Yes.
But we should give people who've never heard of one of our other podcasts, you should totally go listen to the older ones, but whatever.
Yeah.
We should tell them what City Skylines is.
So, if you have ever played the game, as I think Mike had brought it up before in a previous episode, SimCity,
mm-hmm.
Then you know what City Skylines is. It's basically an ode to that game. But if you don't know that, then basically this is a game about creating and maintaining your own city.
Yeah.
There are various ways to play, but basically you can play a mode where you start with nothing and you have a limited amount of resources and money, and you grow your city from, you know, just this tiny little village with a few people in it to a giant metropolis. Or you can play in a different way. And I've seen actually some YouTubers do this kind of thing where they just have unlimited amounts of money. And really what they're doing is they're designing like amazing, beautiful cities and really about the aesthetics of the city and how it functions. And they just have unlimited amounts of money and just create whatever they want without any limitations, kind of like you would in Minecraft with creative mode.
Yeah.
So as the mayor / god of the city, you decide where to place basically residential, commercial, and industrial zones. So right away, there are some applications to learning right away as far as those things are concerned, because
sure.
students learn about like the way that towns and cities are developed and why there's certain things placed in certain areas.
Why people don't like to live near factories.
Exactly. So everything you do within the game, I love this part about it, has a consequence. Now, some of them are positive things that end up happening. Some of them are negative things. So, for example, if you put your garbage or your sewage in the wrong place, it will contaminate, for example, the water.
Downstream.
Yes, exactly. If you decide to use cheap power, so in the form of some kind of coal, burning plants, and you put it in the wrong place, it could, or you put it in your city, it could like get your citizens sick, and then that costs your city money, you know,
mm-hmm.
and eventually, you know, your citizens could, you know, perish. And I just love the way that each decision drives a consequence, either positive or negative, throughout the game. So how does this version, this is the teacher gaming EDU version of it, how does it compare, you know, with graphics and gameplay to the commercial version? Because I've played that version and so have you.
Yeah.
So you know what it actually is. And I actually couldn't see absolutely any difference.
So they didn't dumb it down.
They kept it as is. And then just basically what they did is said, hey, you know what? This game is really awesome just to play. But there's also all of this learning that can take place on it. And that's really the educational component that I'm going to talk about next, which is basically what they've done with teacher gaming is they've created various lessons that you could use in a variety of different content areas. I think mostly to like spark your ideas, mm-hmm. you know, so you can then create lessons. But these are lessons you can plug and play right away. And they include like the outcomes. So there's specific things. They didn't link them to any standards, which is, I think is kind of good. They just said, here's an outcome that you could do. And then you could then go and say, okay, this relates to science standard, blah, 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 or whatever it might be, or economic standard, et cetera, whatever you're doing. But basically, they include the outcomes, they include resources, which I love this part. There's a whole section on these open ed resources. For example, things that are connected to news articles or things on Wikipedia kind of links or those kinds of things so you can learn about specific topics. There's some questions to ask the students to before, during, and after playing the game scenarios. And the lessons are really well thought out. I thought they were really, whoever wrote these things really has an eye on education. You know, sometimes when we see some kind of like plug and play type things, Mike, we read them, we're like, gosh, who wrote this? Obviously it wasn't a teacher, right?
Yeah.
And this is very well written as far as, and a really good resource for a teacher to be like, okay, cool, I'm gonna pull these, be able to plug these in and then adapt it to whatever I'm actually teaching. So my 11-year-old son played through two of the lessons. One of them is called Cities and Finance. And one of them is called Curing the Epidemic, and I, as he was playing it, I basically was just asking him, like, how he's feeling about things. And his comments were, like, one of the comments I really liked, he said, this is actually really hard during one of the times he was playing it because
good.
Things weren't going his way.
Yeah.
And then the other one, a comment that he made, he said, I don't usually play these types of games. You know, it's kind of a game that I would play. I'm into that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But he said this was actually awesome. He really liked it. It was challenging. And then I asked him questions afterwards, and he was basically reflecting on his actions that took place during the game and saying, oh, I should have done these things. And then so then I could ask higher level questions and say, what do you think if we actually did this in a city? What would actually be the impact? So really kind of making the connection between this video game and the real world. And I thought, freaking awesome. Super awesome connections. Really, really good game. I like the game anyway, but it was kind of like when Minecraft first came up, where we were like, okay, how are we going to apply this to education? And then we were like, oh my gosh, there's a million ways we can apply this to education. Same thing here. Really, really good game. I'm glad that he didn't dumb it down or do anything like that as far as the gameplay itself. So we've actually ran some different ads for teacher gaming, but I'll go ahead and let you know once again that if you want to go ahead and just try this out, you just need to go to teachergaming.com, and then you could actually call them up, and they give you a 15-minute walkthrough, and then they give you a 30-day free trial to try it out for yourselves and see if is it worth it. You know, is this something that I actually could use in my classes?
Yeah.
And as we've said several different times, we're actually giving away also a free subscription for one lucky teacher.
We are.
Yes. So Woo. It's going to be awesome.
Awesome.
So, yeah.
Well, that sounds amazing. I mean, I'm a huge fan of City Skylines. I've been playing it since it came out. I knew about it before it came out, and I was enraged at how terrible SimCity was.
Yes.
So I am thrilled with how awesome this is. So, that's great. And you should go on teachergaming.com and take a look and see if this interests you. When we come back, we will chat with our very good friend Steve Isaacs and his daughter.
Friends, On Podcast Media is getting set to launch not one, but two new podcasts this summer. And we're excited to tell you about the first one, On Politics. On Politics is hosted by politician, professor, and human rights lawyer Craig Scott. On Politics will take deep dives into policy and politics. You definitely come away learning something every week. To stay up to date with On Politics, follow the show's Twitter account, @OnPoliticsPod.
So, welcome back, everyone. We are here with our special guests, Steve Isaacs and his daughter, Layla, here at the ISTE conference on Sunday still. And you guys just finished earlier this morning presenting a session, which I thought was super special because you're actually bringing in students and having them present, which I think is, as I've been looking around at the conference today, I've actually seen a lot of students here. Yeah. I think that is a critical piece. What did you guys present on, Steve? Like, what can you tell us about?
So we presented on student choice and in learning, and, you know, which kind of goes hand in hand with student voice. And, you know, Layla, myself, Curran, who's the CKO, the chief kid officer of DigSit Kids, and his mom, Mary Alice. And, you know, maybe Layla wants to talk a little bit about what our session was about.
Well, it was just kind of briefly about how, well, for my dad's classroom, how it's like very choice-based and not really very structured standard learning. And then like me and Curran talked about how we're using choice to do crazy things in the real world.
Awesome.
That's awesome.
That sounds really cool. Yes. So within your classroom, we're talking about like ability to go like different, like quest-based learning.
Yep, exactly right.
Yes. So for our audience members that don't know what that even means, they hear quest-based, they're like, oh, this is something crazy. It really isn't. It's something they can apply right now as far as a technique in their classrooms. Right?
Yeah, I believe so. So, you know, in my case, I have a series of quests under different topics that kids can explore, you know, as they wish. So, you know, basically the structure of my class is that kids choose one of the areas, you know, the learning outcomes all revolve around what I'm trying to achieve with my students anyway, but they have a lot of choice in which path they take. So, for example, I teach game design and development. You know, some of the kids, you know, might want to learn directly about coding, but in game development, there are so many different, you know, roles in the game industry, so I don't think every kid has to necessarily be, you know, a code monkey or what have you. So the kids that do choose that, they can start taking quests around coding, learn coding. A lot of it ends up being self-paced, independent with my support. They might be doing things with like Code Academy or something. So there are a lot of these great resources out there. And then, you know, meanwhile, at the same time, a kid might be looking at, you know, analyzing game mechanics, which is going to play into the games they create. So they might be looking at our, I have a quest line called Journey to the Center of the Game, where they're playing games, reviewing them, and critically analyzing them for, you know, the things that I want them to be looking at, which is going to, again, in turn, play into what they do when they're creating their games. And then on another note with regard to choice, when, like, every kid ends up creating a final project, which is a game of some sort, but even there, they all have total autonomy in terms of choosing what tool they want to use. So I'll have kids creating a text-based adventure with Twine, or kids that really want to learn Unity to create a game or content for VR. Other kids might be using Minecraft to create a game within in Minecraft. They're all going through the same process of iterative design, but again, there's another element of choice thrown in there. But the quest-based model is really all about giving kids these opportunities for different learning pathways, giving them as much flexibility and choice as, you know, as you can, and, you know, but yet still, you know, making it work for whatever your, you know, content area is.
That's awesome. So how did you guys then connect that, like, Layla's here and Curran with what you were just talking about, Layla, like where you're doing some things outside of the classroom? So what was, like, your component, or what was your part?
Well, in your case, too, like, what drives you towards choice? Because, like, you know, I guess in my case, I'm creating a choice-based environment for my students. Have you had that in school?
No.
So that hasn't happened as far as within school. But it would be something that would be appealing, yes.
But you're still going out there and implementing choice in what you want to learn. So maybe talk to that a little bit.
So just recently I've been like really intrigued in zero waste, and I'm hoping that it'll get approved for my Girl Scout Gold Award. But if not, like, I've already done like 7.5 hours of research, just like kind of on my own. I haven't even like finished some of the requirements I need to start my Gold Award, so we'll see how that goes over. But like, that was me just out of the blue, like, choosing, like, oh, this is what I want to do. Like, so much recycling is, like, not actually recycled. And then, right, like, all this, all these, like, issues in the wildlife, like the turtles with the straws and plastic forks up their nose that they need to, I saw a video of that, that they need to, like, get out. But it's, yes, like, straws, like, are just, like, everything's, like, back. Yeah.
Yeah. So she's going out, and students like Layla are going out, and they're finding their passions and going out and learning about those things and putting in hours of work, whether or not this applies to that specific badge that you're talking about,
right,
it's still super important to you. And so that learning takes place. That's a good thing for us as educators to remember, that there's so much out there that our students are super passionate about, yeah, and to try to find ways for us to connect to those things, right, and then bring them into the classroom. Because if she was able to do that in a class, it's like, you know, in a science class, for example, environmental science, and then that could turn into an awesome project of some sort that at the end she could actually do, you know, have an action plan then at,
right,
the end to,
right,
apply it.
Yeah. So part of the frustration, I think, is that in this case, she's going to do it outside of school, but it might not even ever be acknowledged or recognized within school. She might not ever get credit for that as being a worthwhile project yet. Like, what skills are you learning while you're doing it? I mean, like, I've never seen Layla research as much as she's researching about zero waste, yes, as she just dove into it. She's creating a website right now, you know, to kind of share some of her things. She even networked with somebody today. Do you want to talk about that, about the
Go Bubble?
Yeah.
So today, after our presentation, Henry, is it?
Yeah.
Henry came up to you first, right? And then you were like, oh, talk to him. And then, well, this network, which is like Facebook for kids, called Go Bubble, is, he said that it would be like really easy for me to get the word out, and like not just out to like New Jersey out or like Chicago, wherever, but like out like to Greece and like all around the world. So it's like we can all like make this change in our lifestyles.
Yeah. That's awesome. That's a way to be able to go ahead and do that safely, be able to put it out, and then get that message out to more kids who are actually also interested, for example, in zero waste.
Yeah. And one of the interesting things too is that one of the things about the Gold Award in particular is that it's supposed to be something sustainable, meaning that, like, you know, Layla shouldn't do all this work and then have the project be over and she presents it and, okay, so I learned about,
nothing,
you know,
happens after.
Right. The idea is that it should be the message should be carried however that's going to be. So sometimes it might be a younger Girl Scout troop that takes it on. In this case, by this connection she made today, this might be her audience that's going to sustain this and become a community around this. And, like, I mean, it doesn't get more authentic, you know, than that.
Yeah. Yes. And we were talking yesterday at the Batch Summit about exactly what you're talking about, where you have done all of this work, and in the end, you're going to have this awesome product and even these connections, and you should get credit for it at your school. You know, we're talking about how our systems are in place where they don't make any sense. The real learning that you might actually do there could blow away many of the courses and classes that you may end up taking because of how passionate you are towards that learning.
Totally.
And being able to give people credit for the things that they have actually, you know, skills that they've learned, and then all of the things that they've actually done, you know, whatever it actually might be. So, Mike, you had some, we were going to talk some, on a switch a topic a little bit here.
So, while you're doing another session at the Tinker Booth, so why don't you tell us just a little bit about what you're doing later on this week?
Sure. So, recently I got involved as one of the Tinker Blue Ribbon Educators. And one of the things I'm most passionate about, which is what got me really interested in Tinker, is that you can code in Tinker and have your code executed right in Minecraft. So in this case, through Code Connection, which is, you know, a program you launch within Minecraft Education Edition, you can choose either Scratch, Code.org, Make Code, or Tinker, and actually you're coding with the block-based language in this case, and executing your code and seeing it, you know, happen in Minecraft. So it's super fun, super great way to get kids involved in coding, but, you know, I mean, I'm all for them learning whatever is interesting to them in terms of coding, but Minecraft is so relevant to so many of these kids that when they get the sense that, okay, so if I do this code over here and then see my, in Minecraft, this big building constructed based on this code, or I see the agent and I send him mining for stuff and then bring him back to me and then I collect what he mined for me. I mean, there's so many neat things, you know, and you can get into all facets of programming in terms of, you know, loops, conditional statements, variables, but yet again, it's also tied right in this case, with Minecraft. So that's you know, very cool.
That is very cool. And we're also, we've kind of teased this on Education Twitter channel a couple times, but Glenn and you and myself, we've been playing video games together a little bit. It's kind
there's,
of our,
there's no place for video games in education.
No place for video games in education, but we've been playing a little bit of video games, and we're gonna kind of make it maybe semi-official a little. Mm-hmm. So I'm looking forward to playing video games with you guys and
me too.
And hanging out. And we've talked a little bit about it, I guess, but I think it'd be fun to have, you know, people join us and chat and even play with us, depending on the game and how many people can actually be in it at the same time.
Yeah.
Because there's obviously lots of games that we could possibly play, but having people who want to learn more about games-based learning and how to integrate video games, like legit video games, into the classroom. I mean, I feel like we're three pretty good people to talk to about that. So it'd be fun to have more people come and join us and chat, and we can talk. And literally, it's like, I think it's one of the coolest egalitarian ways to like have everybody and just share and collaborate all in like one space live.
Yeah.
And having fun while we're doing it. So it's gonna be great.
It's gonna be great. It kind of reminds me too of like for World of Warcraft, there are two like educational game-based learning oriented guilds, and it's a similar thing. Like
we when should I was play WoW.
Yeah, well, we should play WoW. And we could bring a lot of people into WoW. But so they're still, you know, alive and well. One is called Cognitive Dissonance, and that's on the Alliance side, and on the Horde side, and I don't know why. Inevitable Betrayal is the name of that guild, which came as a betrayal of the Cognitive Dissonance guild. But it's pretty amazing, because, and I should really get in there more. I always felt like it was the combination of like a, you know, almost like a Twitter chat and gaming at the same time, which is what we're kind of striving for.
Exactly.
And it was just awesome. You'd be playing, and then all of a sudden the conversation in your team or your guild chat breaks out about game-based learning. I mean, that's what we're going to bring in. We're going to have voice associated. I mean, 100%.
So it's going to be exciting. So stay tuned. We are working on lots of fun stuff related to that. It'll be mostly sourced through the On Education portal and website and stuff like that. But we're gonna create a channel, and there's going to be video, and you're going to have all that stuff. And so stay tuned, because it's going to be pretty rad, and we're really excited to do that. It's going to be a ton of fun.
Yes.
Ton of fun.
Thanks so much, Steve and Layla. You guys are awesome.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
On Education is an On Podcast Media production. My name is Mike Washburn. My co-host is Glenn Irvin. You can get in touch with us or ask us questions to answer on air by visiting our website, oneducationpodcast.com. You can tweet us at oneducationpod. Glenn is at Irv Spanish on Twitter. I can be found on Twitter at Mr. Washburn. Our sound engineer is Jake Codeweiss. He's on Twitter at JK Radio. You can find us on Facebook by visiting facebook.com/oneducationpod. If you're enjoying the show and think others would too, we would be honored if you shared it with them. Please leave us a rating or review in Apple Podcasts or the Google Play Store. When you leave a rating, it gives our rankings a boost. This helps others discover the show. We want to thank our presenting sponsor, Schoology, for supporting us. Check out schoology.com to learn how they can help you advance what's possible. Thanks as always for listening. Stay awesome. See you soon.